13 minutes.
Your day is nonstop.
Now your news is too.
13 minutes.
13 minutes, nonstop news.
And your first warning forecast.
Nothing but news and weather for 13 minutes nonstop tonight at 11. 13 ABC Action News.
13 minutes, 13 ABC.
We'll deal with it the best we can if this is the way it's going to turn out.
It could be a tragic development in the baby Elena case. The coroner confirms the discovery of what appear to be human remains. Today's development sparked a fight among a few dozen gathered in the East Side neighborhood where Elena was last seen.
We're going to go away, but there's a family here that has to learn how to go on with their life.
And 3 months of looking for answers and holding out hope have possibly come to an end. We begin 13 minutes of nonstop news with breaking news in the search for a missing Toledo toddler. It all went down this afternoon when police served a search warrant at a home on Federal Street in East Toledo. Police found a box in a garage, and in that box, potentially, the answer to the question that has haunted many for the past 3 months. Where's baby Elena? Good evening, everyone. I'm Diane Larson.
And I'm Lee Conklin, live on Federal Street, where it is the end of what has been a gut-wrenching day for the people of this community. The search warrant served by authorities around 3:36, 3:40 this afternoon at 704 Federal Street. And inside that home, the home of Stephen King, the ex-boyfriend of baby Elena's mother, authorities found a box. The Lucas County Coroner's Office telling us tonight it does appear to have human remains inside. The coroner working to confirm those findings tomorrow.
Fatal warnings have been issued.
Okay. Hold on, Lee. If you're on the phone, we thank you.
That'd be Lucas County, Wood, Ottawa, and Sandusky County.
Okay. As we just talked about with that rotating storm there, the National Weather Service has issued a tornado warning, folks, for Lucas, Wood, Ottawa, Sandusky counties. That warning goes until 3:15 p.m., and that's that area we're watching there, south of Waterville, west of Dunbridge, moving to the east. So at this time, if you live in the path of this storm, take cover immediately. Get away from the windows, interior room, low levels, places that are protected from the glass and the windows. And you can see there the outline. This is live Doppler 13,000 HD, but here it is. This is the new warning for a possible tornado. It's a tornado warning until 3:15. This is the polygon as that storm is tracking to the east northeast at about 30 to 40 miles per hour.
In addition, let's take a look at our graphic system. The folks can see the red box. We talked about this just a few moments ago that we saw Cleveland area go under a tornado warning, and that was why we were quite concerned about these rotating thunderstorms. In addition to the tornado warning, there are flash flood warnings in effect for Lucas County and Wood County also. So our live Doppler 13,000 radar continued to track this rotation from Lucas County, Wood County, Ottawa County, Sandusky County. So take this quite seriously. This is a very volatile, changeable situation. So once again, tornado warnings. You might hear some sirens going off in your community, and this is the reason why Lucas, Wood, Ottawa, Sandusky County under tornado warnings. Ross and Jay, anything new on your end over there?
Ross is grabbing some new information, Bill, so let's go to live Doppler 13,000 HD and track this dangerous storm. Now have four shear markers. We have two of the red shear markers, two of the yellow, and that storm tracking to the east-northeast, about 30 to 40 miles per hour. So places within the path of the area of rotation here. I know it's probably storming out ahead of this, but it's on the back edge of the more intense precipitation. Areas in the path of the storm, take cover now.
I got a man open.
It's the Northwest Ohio Ford Dealers Border Battle Kickoff Show, live from the Big House in Ann Arbor. Here's 13ABC Sports Director Dave Holmes.
Welcome high above Michigan Stadium. Welcome to the 110th plane of the game. Welcome to the Northwest Ohio Ford Dealers Border Battle Kickoff Show. I'm Dave Holmes. We have you covered all morning up until the kickoff at noon shortly here on 13ABC. And we have all hands on deck today. Standing by, Eric Haubert, Joe Nugent, both with me here at the Big House Live. We also have Steve Slivka back in the studios.
Let's go.
It's a big world, and now we're loving this town. It's our turn, so put your hands up. Don't be scared, take a chance. Come on, give me a hand. It's time to laugh, time to smile. Now let's get up and dance. Come on, everybody, let's live it up. Let it out if you can't get enough. This right here gonna make you jump.
Jump, jump,
this is home. Hey, yeah, this is home.
Keeping you updated on the very latest with the Boston Marathon explosions. More than 170 people now hurt by the blast. Three people were killed, among those 8-year-old Martin Richard. His mother and younger sister suffered serious injuries. Today, President Obama said the bombings were an act of terrorism, but the motive and the people or person behind the blast are still unknown. People briefed on the investigation say the bombs were packed into pressure cookers and then loaded with nails and ball bearings. Investigators say they've gotten numerous tips and have been interviewing witnesses and analyzing the crime scene, called the biggest crime scene ever in Boston police's history. An Oregon middle school teacher finished that marathon 2 minutes before the first explosion at the finish line. 13ABC's Christine Long live in Boston at Logan International Airport with that incredible story, Christine.
Diane, Lisa Stevens is exhausted. Her flight is just about to take off, taking her back home to Northwest Ohio. Stevens finished the Boston Marathon in 4 hours, 6 minutes, and 27 seconds. And little did she know at the time, 2 minutes may have saved her life.
This was my first Boston. Quite a surreal experience.
Lisa Stevens arrives at Logan International Airport, eager to board her flight home. The teacher and track coach at Facet Middle School in Oregon leaves Boston, having fulfilled a lifelong dream.
I tried to qualify in 2001, so this was a long-awaited journey. So, but it was a wonderful experience until 2 minutes after I crossed the finish line.
As she was getting her medal, the first bomb exploded.
And I looked back and I saw the mushroom cloud. And at first I was like, what the heck? And then instantly another explosion went off, and then people started panicking and hurrying us along.
Those of us out cheering everyone on had no idea what was happening.
Lisa's friend Charissa Urbano was at the 25-mile marker.
I started noticing in the crowd that the crowd started to get quiet, and then everyone was on their phones.
It was overwhelming just trying to even reach anybody. I couldn't reach my mother till 9 p.m.
It took me at least an hour to get to her, just to try to work my way through the barricades.
I saw generous and helpful people, panicked runners, and we all band together and just helped each other.
Why they would choose a marathon and target a marathon, you know, there are athletic events that have hundreds of thousands of people in a crowded area, and the marathon is kind of strung out. So maybe it was just that whole terror of other people not knowing.
Stevens believes in spite of the tragedy, the spirit for Boston's race has not been destroyed.
It's something that the city bands together to support and celebrate. So a lot of them were disappointed, and their main goal is please come back, say you'll come back. And I would.
Reporting from Boston, Christine Long, 13ABC Action News.
And as we've mentioned, a lot of people from Northwest Ohio and Southeast Michigan took part in Monday's race. 13ABC's Jacqueline Policastro continues our team coverage tonight, also live in Boston, with the story of a local runner who saw the explosion. Jacqueline.
Good evening. I can tell you there's now a memorial at the crime scene. People leaving messages, cards, of course, flowers. I talked to you at 6 o'clock this morning, 12 hours ago. I can tell you one of the biggest things that's changed around here is that people are now out and about, using the T, coming home from work, out shopping. But remember, this is still a very active investigation. I did talk to a local runner who ran the marathon, a man from Toledo. After he finished the race, he witnessed the explosion. Nick Appling crossed the finish line in his first Boston Marathon, but he knows other runners weren't as lucky.
Just a sad day.
Appling ran cross country at Oak Harbor High School, and now he lives in Toledo.
Did I think, coming from a small town, Oak Harbor, Ohio, that I'd be, you know, maybe 100 yards, 50 yards away from, you know, an event like this? No. I mean, no one can ever foresee that.
He was celebrating his marathon finish with family at a charity event at the Lenox Hotel when the explosions happened.
It seemed like a cannon was being shot. So, and then you heard the second explosion, you know, the cops and the firefighters running over to those barricades and just ripping them apart, you know, and you just knew something wasn't right.
At first, everyone was on lockdown inside the hotel.
They were telling us to keep away from the windows, but of course, everyone being curious, you just keep staring out the windows, and then we just tried to focus on the local news.
Then when police worried there might be another attack, Appling was told he couldn't use his cell and had to evacuate and race to safety.
What's your feeling towards whoever did this?
I mean, they're cowards. I mean, you're picking on innocent, you know, bystanders. And it's sad that there's always going to be this thing looming over this.
Of course, this incident changed the Boston Marathon forever. Many of the injured are still in the hospital. I do have some new information. 89 of the 183 people in the hospital have been released. I also know that one of the victims is said to be a Boston University grad student. The big question now is, who is responsible for all of this? You heard the president speak out and authorities here saying they will bring those people or that person to justice. The president is expected to come here on Thursday.
Yeah, and Jacqueline, the runners you talked with today, are they concerned about coming back and doing the marathon again? We know that marathon runners are diehards here. How do they feel?
Absolutely, they are. I talked to Nick about that. He told me he talked it over with his wife and his parents who were here with him in Boston during all of this. And he says that he is not going to let the fear of what happened during this year's Boston Marathon change that. He qualified for next year, and right now he plans to race again.
All right, Jacqueline Policastro, live in Boston. Thanks very much.
Our 13 ABC parking lot is full of Jeeps, but the nameplates on some of them are changing. As our Liberty fleet ages, we're replacing them with Cherokees. And we're taking you along for the ride as we follow our very first one down the assembly lines. Most of us don't think much about what it takes to put our vehicle together, but it's amazing just how much goes into getting a Cherokee from the plant to the showroom.
I've been with the company, as you know, over 26 years, and it's still exciting every day that I come in here, especially now in Toledo, with us having the opportunity to build a brand new vehicle.
It's a truly impressive process getting to the finished product. Takes about a day and a half to build a Cherokee from the ground up, and it all starts right here in the body shop.
This is really the heart and soul of Jeep, is in the body shop.
It begins with the underbody, and as it moves through the line, various parts and panels like doors, hoods, and lift gates are put on. The Cherokee starts to take shape.
Everything you see in here used to be done by hand in the old plant. All the spot welds, over 4,000 of them on a car, were all done by hand. Now it's all robotic.
Once the robots have the frame together, skilled workers called Tech One step in.
They are the last people to touch the car before it heads to paint. What they do is they look for any blemishes, any stamping issues, any imperfection in the sheet metal. If you'll see, they wear cotton gloves. So as you run your hand across the surface, you'll be able to feel any imperfection.
With all this sheet metal comes a lot of safety procedures.
In some areas of the plant, they have to take extra safety precautions. Anyone who handles sheet metal has to wear Kevlar arm sleeves and Kevlar gloves at all times because sheet metal is obviously razor sharp.
Different gloves for different areas, depending on what piece of the car you're handling. Fenders, you might wear a smaller glove. If you're handling body sides, you might wear something heavier.
This plant, out of all assembly plants, has the best safety record in all of Chrysler.
With the new Cherokee line came a brand new 500,000 square foot expansion here in the body shop.
This whole deck is all brand new, never been done in any other body shop. We can reroute the car four or five different directions.
There's also a brand new metrology lab. Metrology is the science of measurement. In the lab, they make sure every square inch of the car comes together perfectly before it hits the lines.
This is very new for us down in Toledo. It gives us a great opportunity to really up the quality level of the vehicle for our customers.
A lot of us told our high school geometry teachers that we would never need it in the real world. And for many of us, that's true. However, here in the metrology lab, it is critical when it comes to building cars.
We're into heavy statistics here. We analyze data, regression analysis, all these terms that people don't know what it's all about, right? All the measurements we do really relate to a lot of functional stuff, the ride and drive of the vehicle, the interior of the vehicle, the sound quality.
From the metrology lab to the body shop, the Cherokee is reinvigorating a lot of workers.
With a new vehicle, it's like a new experience. Even for the older guys like me, it's fun to launch something and then see it succeed out there.
Big storm on Live Doppler 13,000 HD. You're going to want to grab those shovels to prepare.
Jay said there would be days like this, sunny days like this, stormy nights like this. Clouds darken and it starts to blow. There's only one thing you need to know.
You're going to want to grab those shovels to prepare.
What did Jay say?
Oh, is it supposed to snow tonight?
What did Jay say? Watch Jay Burge back at 5, 6, and 11 on 13 ABC Action News.
And here's your shovel.
Thank you.
And here's your shovel.
I thought it was Dad.
Scrambling for safety, hiding in bathtubs and back rooms to survive the Sunday storm.
I looked up and all I saw was the sky, and I just lost it.
The mess gives way to cleaning up, debris dangling from trees and scattered across the landscape. Thousands still powerless, and it could be days before the electricity and the heat are back on. Roads begin to reopen, but others are still blocked by down lines, tree limbs, and power poles.
And from Illinois to Pennsylvania, the damage assessment and cleanup underway in the wake of an unprecedented November storm that made its mark on the Midwest. Good evening, everyone. I'm Diane Larson.
And I'm Lee Conklin. Just this afternoon, National Weather Service confirming an EF2 tornado made its way through Wood and Lucas counties last night. We're told it formed near Lime City Road on US 20 in Perrysburg and continued northeast for about 20 minutes, traveling some 12 miles, finally lifting at Corduroy and Wynn Roads in Oregon. And another twister, this one, an EF1, confirmed on the east side of Jersey City. The National Weather Service says the tornado touched down near Main and Huffman and lifted about a mile east.
And just within the last half hour, another confirmed EF1 tornado, this one just east of Elmore in Ottawa County, and traveled less than a mile. Those tornadoes just part of the bigger weather picture, and we have team coverage of the storm recovery all across the viewing area. Chief Meteorologist Jay Burschbeck has more on the conditions now that the storm has rolled through.
13 ABC's Mackenzie Keyline has an update on the power outages and the road closures.
Alexis Means spent the day in Putnam County, where a tiny community picking up after winds damaged homes and a church.
Daryl Kirkland Morgan in Oregon, where the National Weather Service says that confirmed tornado destroyed several homes.
But we begin with Amy Montgomery in Perrysburg Township at the intersection of Oregon Road and 795. That's where we're told that EF2 tornado reached wind speeds over 110 miles per hour. Amy.
Well, Diane, all you have to do is take a look around and you'll know that that is definitely true. One of the biggest things I'm noticing, though, as we're standing out here and as the sun has gone down, is how dark it actually is. Toledo Edison, they've been out here all day trying to get that restored. You can see them. They're here across the street at what's left of this gas station, trying to get power up and running to the people here in this area. But as I mentioned, there was a lot of damage, not only to homes, but also to businesses. A lot of it flew all the way across the street. We have this very large piece of a roof that came from an industrial park just across 795 here. And like I mentioned, it is very, very dark, but we do have some video that we can show you of some of the damage we shot earlier today. They have trucks that are holding up power lines here in the area. They have the road closed down. Oregon Road, part of it is still shut down. There is a gas station that has essentially been demolished. The part, the overhang over those gas pumps fell in those very high winds. And we checked in earlier today with the Wood County Emergency Management Agency, and they have been out. They've been surveying the damage here in Wood County with the National Weather Service, and we checked in with them to find out what's next in this process.
Our role at this point is really, you know, assessing the damage, seeing exactly what we got, and then towards the end of the day and moving into the second day, we'll start looking at debris removal and a more comprehensive plan on how all that debris is going to get moved.
Now, Gilbert says that Wood County is definitely no stranger to this type of weather. You mentioned the Lake Township tornado in 2010, and he says based on experience, he's hoping to have this area in Wood County picked up by the end of the week. But of course, time will tell how long that will take. But as we mentioned, this was essentially the start point for that EF2 tornado, and it made its way all the way to Oregon, where we find my colleague 13ABC's Daryl Kirkland Morgan. She has more on the damage reports there. Daryl?
Well, you're right. The tornado did end its path here. It hit several areas in Oregon, both residential and commercial businesses, some of them completely taken out. I'm not far from Winning Corduroy Road. I'm in the Eden Park subdivision, and the house that was behind me, it wasn't fully up, but it did have its wooden structures up. The neighbor beside it said that the only thing it was really missing was siding, but tonight you can see completely torn down. Debris from this blown away houses scattered as far as the backyard, some to the neighbor's yard, also up in the trees. I mean, people behind it said they were picking up debris this morning just from the strong winds that came through. One of the men I talked to said it sounded like a freight train came through this area. And we'll actually show you some video that we got last night. It wasn't just houses that were hurt by this. One was the Sundance Kid Drive-In. Screen number one completely destroyed by those strong gusts, well over 100 miles per hour, that came down Navarre Road. Also in Oregon, the Meyer on South Wheeling Street, part of the roof was torn off. They had to shut down the store for a while. It was actually reopened again this morning, but many houses and commercial buildings feeling those strong winds that came through here, and that today has been confirmed it was an EF2 tornado that came through Oregon. So a lot of the neighbors and businesses are just left wondering how they're going to pick the pieces up to get back together. But the neighbors, at least in Eden Park, say they're working together and they're going to make sure that they all are working and doing what they can to clean up what the storm has left behind. Reporting live in Oregon, Daryl Kirkland Morgan, 13ABC Action News.
And those storms wiped out part of Cloverdale, Ohio, a community's church destroyed. Cloverdale, located about 70 miles southwest of Toledo in Putnam County. And our Alexis Means continues team coverage tonight to tell us if that parish plans to rebuild. Alexis?
Well, the pastor says that they will hold mass in the parish next to the church until they decide on what they are going to do. The city is facing some challenges.
The cleanup has begun in Cloverdale. Severe weather blasted the area. The streets are blocked by mangled and downed power lines. The Red Cross says 10 homes were destroyed and debris is everywhere. There's also a 2x4 stuck in Nancy Miller's house. She recalled hearing the destructive winds and heavy rain.
And then it was raining really hard, and then kind of heard that noise, like sound like a train. And I'm like, that sounds like a train. So we hit the bathroom and got in the bathtub.
She believes a tornado touched down in the area. The severe weather blew out the windows in her home.
Heard this god-awful crack, which must have been all that. I don't know, but yeah, it was pretty scary.
Some homes weren't touched. The entire area is without power. The Catholic church is gone. Parishioners and volunteers put on their gloves to help with the cleanup. Parishioners were able to collect a lot of the hymnals. The pastor says they will hold mass in the parish hall next to the church. It's still standing.
This is a very faithful community, a very strong community, very faith-based community.
A community thankful no lives were lost.
You get up and you look at it and it's like amazing. Nobody was hurt.
And it is amazing that nobody was injured. The Red Cross is feeding residents and providing shelter at Oak Haven Residential Center at 125 Main Street in Cloverdale. Reporting live, Alexis Means, 13ABC Action News.
And the storms last night also caused power outages and road closings. 13ABC's Mackenzie Keyline has more on what to expect in your area. Mackenzie.
Diane, we have new outage updates at this hour. We'll go ahead and start with Toledo Edison customers now. Toledo Edison is reporting only 6,000 customers are without power, compared to 11,000 this morning. Majority of those outages are in Wood County, with 500 to 1,500 still without electricity. Edison is working to get that power restored by noon tomorrow. Jerry City also showing a large amount of outages, nearly 500 in that area. City of Toledo has more than 1,000 losses and could be without power until Wednesday afternoon. AEP is also showing new outage numbers. Less than 600 customers in Paulding and Putnam County are without power. Here's a look at Troy Edison's power map showing outages to nearly 100 customers in Dundee, Ida, and Carlton. Consumers Energy estimates power will be turned on to those 2,500 households in Monroe by late Friday afternoon. Now, storm damage has also caused a number of road closures. Summit Street was closed this morning from 100 First Street to Manhattan. That is now open. State Route 199 from Five Point to Rocheton remains closed. And in Monroe County, Lunapeer Road is closed from Bay Creek to Dixie Highway. And just a reminder, Edison crews want to make sure everyone knows to stay away from downed power lines when picking up debris. For a complete list of power updates, you can check out our website, 13abc.com. Reporting live, Mackenzie Keeling, 13ABC Action News.
And we have seen throughout the day the damage assessment just starting, and it is widespread, with Chief Meteorologist Jay Birsbach leading the storm team yesterday. Really tremendous job of getting us through that, you know, calm, cool, collected. But it was a wild night, afternoon and into tonight. And in developing news as we're on the air, another tornado, the third one within the last half hour.
From last night confirmed. Mm-hmm. And this is normal for this situation. What happens is, if the storms pass, they clear. The Weather Service, usually the next day when it's safe, they go out with the day of light or the light of day and assess the damage. And from that, they determine if it was a tornado or straight line winds. And we do have three confirmed now. Let's go to Live Doppler 13,000 HD and review these. Again, these were EF1s and EF2s. That's the new enhanced Fujita scale. That's what the EF stands for. The bigger the number, the stronger the twister. We had an EF1 down here near Jerry City, near Main Street along Huffman Road, went to the east and then lifted. That was an EF1 between 5:35 p.m. and 5:40. So winds with this one were 105 miles per hour to 110 miles per hour. Secondary one we have, zooming off to Ottawa County. This just came in during the 5:30 newscast. Another EF1, 3 miles east of Elmore. This is a around 6 o'clock in the evening, 95 mile per hour winds with that one. And then, of course, the EF2, the biggest one that we had in our area from yesterday so far, began here just on Rocheton Road. Let's see here. Rocheton or Lime City Road in US 20, just east of Rocheton. It skipped, it jumped, went to the north, ended up in Oregon, right about here. And that was an EF2. So with that one, 120 mile per hour winds to 125 mile per hour winds, and that did cause significant damage. For you folks in Putnam County out there, the Weather Service still assessing the damage. We'll have more information as it comes in. Now, looking ahead at the forecast, the gusty winds die down, the sun comes out tomorrow, and some rain, even a bit of snow in the 7-day. We'll have more on that in a few minutes.
Well, unfortunately, when storm damage like this happens, it seems that we get a crop of unscrupulous people trying to make an easy buck off others just trying to get back on their feet. 13ABC I-Team reporter Sean Hagerty live in Oregon with what you should watch out for. Sean.
Yeah, the temptation is going to be to find the first contractor for whatever price to clean up debris like this or what might be left from your home. But if you have somebody you know who's involved in the situation trying to clean up, here's some advice that you need to make sure that they know about. Make sure they've called their insurance company already. Take photos of all the damage they can find, and not to forget your car or truck. And when it's time to start making those repairs, talk to several contractors, get several estimates for the work, evaluate all of them. Don't just take the first offer you hear. Obviously, people want to get their repairs done fast, but the first offer may not be the best offer, and it could be the most expensive. When you do pick a contractor, pay in check or credit card, not cash, and do not pay the full balance until all the work is completed. And you want to make sure that you avoid any sort of insurance adjusters or people that say they're contractors who are walking through neighborhoods. Make sure you call your insurance company and contractors that you know and trust. Make that contact. Don't let them come find you, because you never know who you may run into. Reporting live in Oregon, Sean Hagerty, 13ABC Action News.
The mayor's trip to Germany revolved around one theme: building relationships with regard to economic development, and building relationships with regard to the sister city of Delmenhorst. But the trip started in Hanover at this massive trade show. 6,500 exhibitors, all high-tech firms building our world of the future. And Toledo put on the full court press to recruit development and investment dollars.
The most productive meetings, the most hectic schedule.
Paul Zito recruits international development at the Regional Growth Partnership. He says he met with more than 50 companies in the last week, has 13 strong leads, believes 4 will probably visit Toledo.
They want to look at possible locations, a piece of land or a building. They want to talk to potential suppliers or R&D partners, and they want to talk to our local businesses that can provide services.
The building itself is self-sustainable from the standpoint of energy, from heating and cooling. So look at that. As a glass city, we should have something like that.
The mayor looked at the Sustainable City of Tomorrow, exhibit after exhibit showing how cities of the future will live and grow. The mayor saw all the robotic technology, the new industrial automation, even new energy generation.
He was quite interested in the windmills he saw here because of getting new energy in the city.
He also had a great chance to compare Toledo's recycling operation with what is considered a model European program.
This is basically confirmation that we're doing it the way it needs to be done.
And Mayor Mike Bell strengthened his warm relationship with the mayor of Delmenhorst, who looks at Toledo as a city he can emulate.
What are Toledo's strategies to develop into more service sector oriented business?
So with the personal relationship built between the two mayors and the potential for business development because of personal conversations, Mayor Mike Bell sees the Germany trip as valuable investment in Toledo's future.
I'm really energized by some of the things I've seen. I think that one of the things that we live inside a box in Toledo where we don't believe we can do anything differently. And what they live in here is a country that respects the oldness of their city, but they still are very creative in being able to utilize space and buildings and things like that, and I think that we have to be more aggressive in doing that.
So now the mayor's trip to Germany is complete, and all the business cards and the handshakes and the meetings could lead to visits to Toledo and perhaps some economic development for our city. The long march to job creation may have continued with a walk through Germany. Traveling with the mayor in Germany, Bill Horman, 13ABC, Action News.
From 13ABC, Conklin and Company, with 13ABC Action News anchor Lee Conklin. First, with what's happening behind the headlines. And Take Three, our panel of political analysts.
Morning, everybody. Welcome into another edition of Conklin and Company. Today on the program, we're going to preview two very special events for two adorable little girls, both facing the incredible challenges that come with the accelerated aging disease called progeria. Parents of Kaylee Helko and Carly Kudzia join me a little bit later. But first in studio today, making his second appearance in studio on Conklin and Company, is the junior senator from Ohio, U.S. Senator, Republican Rob Portman. Senator, thanks for coming in.
Lee,
we appreciate
great to be
it.
With you again.
It is a pleasure to have you. And I tell you, Americans' heads are spinning right now, Senator, with the confluence of events that have happened over the last week and a half, and what is going to happen,
what will happen,
moving forward. And as we tape here on Friday, the U.S. House has just passed the bill or the measure, the resolution to defund Obamacare. Mm-hmm. And your Ohio colleague, House Speaker Boehner, basically putting the laying down the gauntlet, challenging the United States Senate now to do the same. You don't have control. So where is this going? And like I said, I think that when it comes to the Affordable Care Act, the debt ceiling, Americans don't know what to think right now. Yep. And it's all on the United States Senate. Yep.
All on us.
All on you. Big job.
Yeah. Well, thanks for having me back on Conklin
you
Company.
Bet.
And it is a difficult time, and also, you know, it's an important time. Mm-hmm. Obamacare also starts being implemented in just a couple weeks with the exchanges. And the debt limit is approaching probably late October now, it looks like. So you got this combination, as you say. What they passed today was a defunding of Obamacare, but also a measure to keep the government operating mm-hmm. because the spending bills have not been done. So you have to
the appropriations.
The appropriations, which you have to have as a continuing resolution, which basically continues the spending from last year. It's at the same level of spending from current fiscal year. So the two are attached together. There's also some other extraneous stuff on it,
and
but those are the two
deadline
things.
Is October 1st. The new fiscal year is October 1st,
right,
correct?
Right. September 30th is the last day of this fiscal year, so we've got to move on it, move quickly.
4 years ago, more than 130 people were trapped on an ice floe after it broke off from the Northwest Ohio shoreline. One man died from what appeared to be a heart attack. This winter, a woman walking across the Maumee River fell through the ice. She spent most of an hour in the frigid water before being taken to safety. In January, a man ice fishing on Timber Lake in Lenawee County fell through the ice and drowned. Lake and river ice can be extremely dangerous.
You may have an area where there's not much current, you have thicker ice, and then several feet or several yards away, you have an area where there is more of a current and there's less ice, and someone could fall through that.
With Great Lakes ice, it's very unpredictable.
The Coast Guard outfitted me with gear.
You may get a little bit of water in that.
And I got the chance to practice an escape to safety.
Currently falling through the ice on the Maumee River, and this is a self-rescue. I'm wearing a suit that makes it much easier. Use my arms to get out. And now we're rolling away. Broke part of the ice.
Keep your arms close together and walk yourself out with your elbows so you can get yourself out there and try to kick. Once you are safely up onto an ice shelf, you want to roll away from that ice hole. The reason for we ask you to roll is because it disperses your body weight and you're not going to be breaking any more ice.
The dry suits that we're wearing make it much, much easier to do this self-rescue simulation because these suits trap some air against our bodies, making us a little bit more buoyant. Also, since they are dry suits, I only got wet from my elbows to my fingertips. This would have been a very different experience without these expensive suits. The body's first response to frigid water is cold shock. In an instant, a victim has a gasp reflex, which is extremely dangerous in the water.
If you are low enough into the water, you can have water go down your throat and you can start the process of drowning.
Get your bearings despite the extreme shivering and intense pain.
People would want to try to fight, kick it, and they're going to tire themselves out. So remain calm, try to get to something that can float, and then try to yell for help when you can.
Face the direction that you came from. In that direction, at least a distance away, is ice that had been strong enough to support you. If you can, use your arms to push up and out of the ice, and in a controlled manner, kick your feet. If you can't get all the way out, rest as much of your body out of the water as possible. Stay calm, but keep in mind it is a race against time.
You've been in water 7 minutes, conscious and responsive. 7 minutes, conscious, responsive. Sir, are you by yourself?
I'm by myself.
He's by himself. By himself, all right, sir, hang on to the ice shelf.
All right.
We're approaching the victim.
As hypothermia begins to set in, the Coast Guard says blood will flow away from the extremities and fluid and muscles begins to congeal and control of arms and legs is lost.
But it could take minutes, and it all depends on people's health conditions and what they're wearing. Again, that's why we preach, wear a life jacket, bring heavy clothing.
Yes, a life jacket, even if you're spending hours dry on the ice.
That's going to help keep you afloat, and it's going to keep you warm longer, and it's going to save your life. Making sure they bring out a whistle, bring out a radio, VHF radio, we listen to Channel 16.
There are often signs of trouble before the ice breaks.
You can get a spongy sensation, you can start hearing cracking, and then when you start hearing that cracking, it feels like it's going to give way. You can get low so you can disperse your body weight so that way you can safely get yourself off of the ice.
Otherwise, in the water, you may only have minutes to live.
3, 2, 1.
Yeah, it's going down. We're about to live it up, y'all. Let's go.
It's a big world, and now we're loving this town. It's all time. So put your hands up. We on the big screen. And everybody's here living out our dreams. Dreams, whoa.
We've seen debris flying everywhere and a big cloud, looked like a mushroom cloud, I'd say 200 foot in the air.
A community looking for answers in the wake of a deadly morning explosion that leveled a home, plus.
We're certainly not naive. We know there's gangs in our community.
Keeping that community safe, the new effort by Monroe Police to crack down on gang problems.
Plus, the plan some lawmakers are brewing up to help smaller beer makers compete with the big names in the business.
First, continuing coverage of breaking news that we've been following throughout the day. Another house explosion, this time in Henry County, leaving one person dead and another hurt, and a community rattled. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Lee Conklin.
And I'm Diane Larson. It's the second house explosion in our area in just the past 2 weeks. Our team of reporters has been on the scene all day long gathering the late-breaking developments.
And today's blast happened around 7:30 this morning on County Road 9 near Liberty Center. People say they could feel it. They could feel that explosion as far away as Napoleon. 13 ABC's Christine Long spoke with people in the neighborhood who saw the chaotic scene unfold this morning.
But we begin with Amy Montgomery live on the scene with an update to the investigation. And Amy, what are police and fire crews telling you?
Well, Diane, they're still trying to determine exactly what happened here this morning, but they do suspect that a gas leak was the culprit for this explosion at this home. But if you take a look here, you can see many neighbors are out here on the scene. They're really assessing the damage. They're trying to help in this cleanup process. But firefighters from several different departments responded here just after 7:30 this morning. The home was fully engulfed in flames. 72-year-old Stephen Collins was rescued by neighbors and rushed to the hospital where he's recovering tonight. But 63-year-old Judy Garwood, who neighbors say was Collins' girlfriend, did not survive. And though this day has obviously been difficult and unbelievable, the fire chief says it could have been much worse.
It's tragic for everybody because in the small community we're in, we're not really highly trained at this. We got half mile to a mile of, you know, debris. We're looking at five or six houses in this row that all have damage in it. The two nearest to them are, you know, significantly damaged. People just don't see it. A lot of people were in bed. Kids were out front getting ready to get on the school bus. We're just lucky today.
And as we've been out here all day, we're learning more about the people that were inside of the home. Neighbors describe both Collins and Garwood as great people who would do anything that they could to help. And we've actually just learned from somebody who was out here on the scene that Collins was a Vietnam War veteran, and he actually had a Purple Heart, and it went missing in this blast. Now they're asking the community to really keep their eyes open, especially the people out here that are helping in this cleanup process. And they're asking anyone who sees it to please return it to the fire department. For now, reporting live in Liberty Township, Amy Montgomery, 13 ABC Action News.
It's a mess. I mean, obviously, the first thing you see when you look at it is, wow. You know.
Now, first responders call that scene unbelievable. The shocking, scary morning for not only neighbors but also for children on their way to school. 13 ABC's Christine Long spoke with neighbors. It continues our live team coverage from the Liberty Center area in Henry County tonight. Christine.
Lee, a Liberty Center school bus was actually turning onto this road this morning when the home exploded. Those students watched the blast. It's a blast that could be felt from miles away.
Charred envelopes, patio chairs, an electrical socket blown clear out to the road. It's widespread debris from the leveled home of Stephen Collins. Debris spread throughout the soybean field across the street.
My kids were standing there. They seen it too. And I can't explain it. I guess it's something you'd see on TV in the movies.
I had went back to bed, hear this huge boom, and stuff's flying everywhere. I thought we had been hit by a plane.
Jean Sonnenberg lives right next door in the gray house. Her home suffered major damage. The roof caved in. The family believes they'll have to demolish.
It's very emotional. I mean, my house is, it looks like it's still there, but it's gone. It's going to have to come down.
Lindsay Krogoka lives a half mile away. She helped carry the homeowner, Collins, who was injured but talking. She helped carry him from the backyard out to the road.
And at that point, he kept telling us, you know, Judy's in there, and firearms are going off in the house. So I told him, like, we have to grab him. We have to go. We have to get you up to the front.
Krogoka says Collins told her his girlfriend, Judy Garwood, had the day off of work and was taking a shower when the home exploded. Garwood died. Firefighters found her in the basement.
Just shook up. I mean, after all said and done, my dad came up, and I mean, it was just nice to hug my dad and, you know my dad was fine and it wasn't us. I mean, horrible that happened to anybody, but it just makes you feel closer to family, I guess.
The Sonnenbergs are only beginning to clean up.
My son's getting married in a week and a half, and we're just gonna get through it with our friends and by the grace of God.
The Red Cross is helping next door neighbors whose homes suffered severe damage. They have booked hotel rooms for those families. Lee, back to you.
Christine, those kids actually saw this unfold on the way to school. How are they doing tonight?
Lee, the Liberty Center school superintendent says this was tragic. Her thoughts and prayers go out to the families and neighbors involved here. She said counselors were on hand today to talk to those students who were on the bus and watched this terrifying explosion.
Feel for all those people. Thank you very much. 13 ABC's Christine Long live in Liberty Township tonight.
And today's house explosion in Henry County comes on the heels of another one just last week in Wood County. Two people were killed in that one. Three others hurt when a house exploded in Troy Township. Today, 37-year-old Andrew Schulte and his mother, 63-year-old Jan Richards, were buried. The investigation into that case and today's are in the early stages, but in both, a gas leak is suspected. And while there is no official cause, experts say that explosions are more common at the start of the heating season.
Whether it's propane or natural gas, I mean, these are both definitely dangerous systems if they're not being maintained. The reason why is because the moisture can cause breakdown in our metal components of the system. We can end up with holes in the flue liner, rotting. We're not doing this to scare you or to try to make you spend more money. We're doing this to protect you because that's what our job is.
And experts say if you smell gas in your house, get out immediately. Do not call for help from inside the home. For fear of a spark, go to a neighbor's house and call the fire department. And stay with 13ABC for continuing coverage of this breaking news alert, both on air and online. Our crews are on the scene. We're working to get you the latest updates. Of course, much more on the situation at 11 during 13 minutes of nonstop news. And we are following at this moment breaking news out of Toledo. Police are investigating a drive-by shooting. This happened at Lawrence and Norwood. Police say a person was shot in the side and the hand, but is expected to recover. Police are looking for a blue Cutlass. That's all they have to go on, but so far, no suspects.
And we're following some breaking news with our media partner, The Blade, tonight. The Spitzer Building in downtown Toledo is set to close December 1st. Building went up for auction back in June, but no one bid on it. There are currently a few offices and a restaurant inside.
And we have some new details tonight on that chemical release at the BP refinery in Oregon. Crews evacuated workers on part of the site yesterday after hydrogen sulfide was released into the air, and they also blocked traffic to keep people safe. Tonight, a BP spokesperson tells 13ABC the investigation continues into just why the sulfur recovery unit shut down. We're told workers are slowly getting it back online. Right now, they haven't detected any issues, but environmental experts are continuing to monitor the situation.
Quick note to pass along to people in Continental. Village leaders have issued a boil alert. We're told it's the result of a water line break. Now, if you live south of the railroad tracks, you're advised to boil water before drinking or cooking with it. This boil alert is in effect for the next 48 hours.
New at 6, it's one community's effort to crack down on crime. Monroe City Police are trying to stay ahead of the gang issues in their area. 13ABC's Alexis Means joins us now live with more. Alexis.
Well, the police department has formed a task force that meets once a month to go over their game plan to deal with the gang problem.
It's a growing problem from Chicago to Toledo. Gang violence. Now the city of Monroe is creating a system to ID troublemakers on their streets. Tracy Williamson has lived in Monroe for 45 years.
The sad thing now is it's getting to be more young kids. I mean, I've seen the kids as young as my son, 11, involved in this, and they're running bike theft rings. All kinds of stuff.
A little over a year ago, Monroe City Police formed the Monroe County Gang Coalition. Officers started recognizing graffiti in certain areas. Some graffiti is an indicator of gang activity. Sergeant Charles McCormick says they also recognize some of Toledo's gangs and folks being released from prison as a growing problem in the area.
They certainly have these, you know, members coming out on parole who are very active in the gangs inside the prison system. And they're obviously going to bring those propensities with them onto the streets.
Officers have started gang sweeps. They also document gang affiliations, tattoos, colors, and graffiti in neighborhoods. Sergeant McCormick says the community is the department's best resource in handling the problem. Neighbors like Williamson, who are the eyes and ears of the streets.
We refuse to let them take over our area. We stand together. Like, I watch her back, the other old lady down there. She's, you know, we just take care of one another.
She knows the gang issue won't get cleaned up overnight, but applauds the police for doing something. In Monroe, Alexis Means, 13ABC Action News.
And we continue to follow the latest developments in the investigation into Toledo toddler Elena Steinfurth's death. This morning, her mother, Angela, made her first court appearance since her daughter's body was found. She's due back in court October 23rd, accused of obstructing justice in connection with Elena's disappearance. Angela's ex-boyfriend, Stephen King, is also behind bars on the same charges. And earlier this month, investigators found Elena's body in a garage in East Toledo. The funeral is set for baby Elena on Saturday. But today we learned her mother will not be able to attend. Angela's attorney filed a motion for a funeral furlough, as it's called, but a judge denied that.
Disasters can strike at any time.
Special event today to help local first responders make sure they're ready for any emergency.
It may look like a pileup on the turnpike, and that's the idea.
We got more than five vehicles, approximately five to extricate.
The 50 vehicles you see here were put this way on purpose to simulate a major wreck on the turnpike. They're actually behind the Center for Emergency Preparedness at Owens Community College. The victims are from five local high schools. They got into the cars and acted hurt. 15 different agencies and eight hospitals then showed up to practice a major response to an accident with mass casualties. It was an event involving 500 people, 18 months in the making, funded by a federal grant to the Toledo Fire Department.
This is just to coordinate all of our resources, to test all our communications and see how we work together.
After all was said and done, emergency managers from Lucas and Wood counties will be able to see what works and what needs work. It's all in an effort to keep you safe.
Now, craft breweries are becoming more popular right here in Northwest Ohio and all over the country. The Brewers Association says this industry grew by 15% between 2011 and 2012. But lawmakers on Capitol Hill say there's something holding them back from really being able to compete with the big names in beer. 13ABC's Washington correspondent Ted Fairliso tells us about a plan to change that.
The United States is a country in the world that has the highest number of different kind of beers, of craft beers in the whole world.
And the Maumee Bay Brewing Company is adding to that statistic. The microbrewery now produces about 2,000 barrels of beer a year.
Our brewing is going up about 200 to 300% every year.
But with all that beer comes a hefty excise tax, $7 a barrel.
We're struggling with it because that's what it is and we have to deal with it.
Pennsylvania Senator Bob Casey says the guidelines for what's considered a small brewery and the tax associated with it has been the same since 1976, even though the beer industry has grown significantly. So he's co-sponsoring the Small Brewer Reinvestment and Expanding Workforce Act, a.k.a. the Small Brew Act.
Make those small firms more competitive by dropping the excise tax on beer.
Specifically cutting the excise tax in half, $3.50 for the first 60,000 barrels produced. It would also redefine small breweries as producing 6 million barrels a year instead of 2.
Harvard did a study which showed that the economic impact of reducing the excise tax is rather substantial and is a job creator both in the first year or two, but even over time.
Any help in that respect would be an investment in creating more jobs, you know, and selling more product, doing more commerce locally.
Right now, the Small Brew Act has 32 co-sponsors in the Senate, Republican and Democrat, including Senator Rob Portman. In Washington, Ted Fiorilliso, 13ABC Action News.
Beautiful weather out there right now. It continues for the next couple of days. Warming for the weekend, but we're still tracking a few raindrops within that 7-day forecast. We're back in just a couple minutes.
Now, 13ABC First Warning Weather with Chief Meteorologist Jay Birchback.
No rainfall out there whatsoever on Live Doppler 13,000 HD or Viper HD. And a neat view of some live action cam views here. This is I-75 in North Toledo. Now, two things to stress on this picture. I think you probably pick up on one. One is that I-75 southbound near the 280 split is just creeping ever so slowly. I think most of what you're seeing are the folks getting on 280, so be aware of this. I believe there's an accident just down the road there, so please be careful. And secondly, look at the glare off the road. This time of the year, the sun sets in the due western horizon, so a good pair of polarized sunglasses and the visor, right? Be sure to use that visor and be prepared for some sun glare on your way. So not the best driving conditions. No rain, no snow, but one, slow going on 75, and two, that blazing sunshine. Current temperature outside, 69 degrees right now. Neat view from South Toledo. Kind of see the buildings out there, and also just a little shake to our camera. Had the winds pick up late today from the east northeast, currently at 12 miles per hour, and that humidity at 55%. Other temperatures, 60s closer to Lake Erie, most of us farther away in the 70s. There's always the exception. Hillsdale, Michigan, that's the exception at 63. Now, your forecast for any rain or cloud cover. I think those few clouds we see out there this evening will go away as the system dives down to our south. But what you're seeing here at 7, It's kind of an area, different shade of cloud cover. This could be some ground fog developing tonight. We've seen it the past several nights, just these little areas that form some patchy fog. Same deal tonight. Best bet for that just west of BG down toward Ottawa. That burns off tomorrow. Lovely, sunny, and dry, highs in the mid-70s. And we'll repeat that here for Friday morning. Patchy fog developing in many spots here. Nothing too thick. And then throughout the day, bright sunshine with highs in the upper 70s. There's your clock. So by 6, 7 o'clock, evening plans, high school football doesn't get much better. Here's your forecast tonight now, the low 47 degrees, mostly clear, cool, patchy fog possible with a calm breeze. Tomorrow, flip-flop those numbers. You get 74, mostly sunny, comfortable, and northeast winds like today, 5 to 15 miles per hour. Checking that 7-day forecast, Friday's high, 77 degrees. For the weekend, starts off really warm on Saturday. Let's zoom in there and you can see 80 for a high, the low 53. On Sunday, with a cold front passing through, a little cooler, rain is likely, and right now centered around midday. So have to watch for the race for the cure in the morning, I believe, is this Sunday. But that rain comes in, moves out quickly, and leaves us high and dry next week, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Lows near 50 and highs in the lower to mid 70s.
It's a real nice stretch, pretty much continuing.
Nice stretch and just that one chance of the next 7 days with the chance, even the chance of rain.
All right, Jay, thanks.
Right. I'm Dave Holmes. Coming up next in sports, Cleveland Indians about to play their final home game of the season. So how do you follow up last night's thriller?
Hello, and coming up on World News, we're going frame by frame over the video of the Navy Yard shooter. We'll tell you what we've learned. And real money tonight on World News. We save a family $500,000 for their future, and you can do it too. Watch tonight.
Cleveland Indians still clinging to a playoff spot. Chris Perez still clinging to a closer's job. Jason Giambi still clinging to the glory days. What a night in Cleveland after Perez blew the save by giving up two home runs in the ninth inning. His buddy Giambi bailed him out in the bottom of the ninth. Two run, two out walk off to keep the Indians in control of the wild card race, which brings us to tonight. Final home game of the year for the Tribe. Here are the current wild card standings. Rays and Indians tied for the top spot. Both teams on 5-game winning streaks. Texas just a game back. Remember, two of those teams will make it. As for the Tigers, they can clinch the division with a win tonight or an Indians loss. Ohio State opens the Big Ten Saturday night against Wisconsin, a game you can see right here on 13ABC. As for the quarterback situation, get this. Braxton Miller and Kenny Guyton listed as co-starters. Yeah, kind of like how we list Lee and Diane as co-anchors, although we know who carries the broadcast. Bowling Green is 1-0 in the MAC. Who is that look for? I'm not even sure. Although they haven't played a conference game in 3 weeks. This week, the BG gets the Akron Zips, a team that hasn't beaten a Division I team all year. Then again, the Zips almost beat the Michigan Wolverines at the Big House.
Definitely, they're a much more experienced group than they were a year ago. They have three returning starters on the O-line, a bunch of guys back on offense and defense. I mean, I think they're a much improved team, and they're headed in the right direction right now. Last year, it was definitely a battle against them. I mean, they had the ball on our one with an opportunity to make it 17-0. So, I mean, that game could have easily went the other way, and we had just fought back and ended up winning.
Tonight at 11, it's our Buffalo Wild Wings Blazing Challenge. This week we have Eastwood High School against Genoa, one of the best rivalries in Northwest Ohio on the field. But which school can throw down 12 Blazing Wings the fastest? It was a sweaty, messy mess. We'll find out tonight at 11. It's easier to have co-anchors than co-quarterbacks. I think it's tough to have two guys take the snap at once. I don't know how that's going to work. They'll figure it out, though, by Saturday.
Thanks for starting something up again.
Just stir the pot.
That's all you do. All right, we're going to check what's out weather-wise in the next couple of hours.
Jay has your evening forecast next as we take a live look from our ProMedica Flower Hospital Action Cam.
And here's a look at live Doppler 13,000 HD. Dry tonight. You can probably see the sunshine out the window. Upper 60s and lower 70s. Forecast does call for a drop off into the 50s by 11 o'clock with a really pretty sunset. Time on that just before 7:30. For tonight, the low 47. Some patchy fog as you wake up on your Thursday, the weekend eve. 74 the high. Beautiful this week on Friday. No chance of rain. 77. Warm and dry Saturday, up to 80. Chance of shower Sunday, focused around midday, 73. And right back into our dry, pleasant, nice weather for Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday.
Outstanding. All right, Jay, thank you. And thanks for watching 13ABC Action News at 6.
Be sure to join us tonight at 11 for 13 minutes of nonstop news. For Lee Conklin, Jay Furstback, Dave Holmes, and all of us at 13ABC, I'm Diane Larson.
World News with Diane Sawyer, straight ahead. Take care, everybody.
Good night.
ABC Action News at 6 is Toledo's number one newscast.